This is my gantry crane, a cheap one-ton model from Harbor Freight. It's fine, mostly. For something with QA so sloppy it came with its own branding labels upside down. But it's just a bit too tall for my shop. It's no effort November again. Though, actually I'm putting in a lot of effort right now. It's just on a large sculptural piece that is a repeat of the migration installation I did a few years ago. And I made a video about that at the time, if you're curious. So I haven't been bothering to film it, which is actually kind of refreshing. I can just do the work without constantly repeating my shop mantra. Think of a shot, get a shot. But before that project started, I wanted to fix all those problems with the gantry crane, and that I did film. Normally I'd save something like this for a shop improvements medley video, but hey, it's November. I'm not quite sure it counts, but since I did the work months ago, a quick video about it is at least low effort, if not quite no effort. The crane's height isn't really a problem inside the shop. I can raise it up between the rafters and that works fine as long as I'm careful to keep the CG directly below the beam, so it doesn't shift. But it was originally too tall to roll out through the garage door. That was a big problem, because tall equipment couldn't get in either, even on a low trailer. So I really needed a way to get the crane outside to do the lift there, and then drop it down onto a pallet jack. So 4 years ago, I replaced the original metal casters with these retractable ones. They aren't rated to hold much weight, but I also added these high-strength rubber feet underneath. The idea was that I could use the casters to roll the crane around to where it was needed, including outside because it was now short enough to get out under the garage door. Then once it was in place, I could drop the retractable casters and it would sit securely on the rubber feet. And this worked great. Except, it turns out in practice I rarely remembered that last step. I'd get caught up in the heat of the moment, usually with the added time pressure of a rental truck that needs to be returned, and I'd lift the load without dropping it off the casters. This put more weight on them than they were ever designed to handle, progressively warping them more and more over the years. The outer shop became littered with ball bearings that dropped out of their twisted, misaligned races. It had gotten to the point that they barely worked at all anymore. But that was just annoying. The real limitation with the crane is that it had always been too narrow, only spanning 94 inches from post to post. This meant pickups and small trailers could get under it, but not anything bigger like flatbeds. And for a lot of the stuff I move, I really need a flatbed. And those, at least all the rentals available around here, are 96 inches wide. I'm utterly perplexed why they didn't make the crane just 6 inches wider, at least until I remember where I got it. But this had frequently posed serious problems when loading sculptural pieces, forcing me to do much sketchier stuff than what I wanted to. With the big sculptural project coming up, I decided it was finally time to fix these problems. That crane is a massive pain to disassemble and reassemble, so once it was down I wanted to do as many upgrades as possible. The mangled retractable casters had to be removed, the original ones put back on, it had to be cut down to be 6 inches shorter, and also made to be at least a foot wider. The top rail of the crane is just a standard S5x10 I-beam, 9 feet long, with some mounting flanges welded onto each end, so replacing it wasn't going to be too hard. I ordered a beam slightly longer than 10 feet and picked it up. Luckily, this was light enough I could just lift it off the flatbed myself, no nasty recursive deadlock. To be clear, making it wider will weaken the crane somewhat. It was originally rated for 1 ton, so I'll have to be careful not to lift anything too close to that mass from the middle of the span. I do have 2 trolleys and chain hoists though, so I usually lift really heavy things using both of them from either side. And it'll only be my own thick skull at risk, so I think it's both a reasonable and morally neutral decision. With the material on hand, it was time to disassemble the crane. This wouldn't be too hard if I could lift it from above while removing the stanchions, but it's the thing I use to lift things from above. I do have these rafters, though, and after messing around with some approaches, I decided that hanging the chain hoists from 2x6s that span 2 rafters and were firmly clamped in place so they couldn't shift over time would work. And for the first time ever, and this was the 3rd time I've disassembled one of these by myself, it actually went pretty smoothly. The beam was held up by the chain hoists, and I was able to remove the tie rods, the struts, and finally the stanchions with ease. I didn't even come close to suffering a back injury this time. Making the replacement for the top beam was pretty simple. My new I-beam came cut to the right length, and all that was needed was a pair of mounting flanges, which were just rectangles made of 1/4-inch plate I had in one of my scrap piles, with holes drilled to match the originals. Normally, not being certified or anything, I would never weld something that hangs over people's heads, unless there was a lot more redundancy in the system than this. But these are big, simple joints that aren't seeing weird loads. It's mostly just compression, with maybe some tension towards the outside. And again, as long as it's just my neck on the line. A quick coat of paint to match the original, and the replacement beam was ready to go. Wider, check. Now to make the crane shorter. Luckily, I still had the original casters. Ah, the pleasures of being a pack rat. With the height of these included, the crane would need to be 6 inches shorter to still pass under the garage door. This would reduce how tall of a thing it could lift, obviously, but I don't think I've ever needed to expand it completely. In the unlikely event I need to lift something taller, I can rent a forklift again. So, in theory, I just had to cut off 6 inches and it would be good. It was a bit more complicated in practice, though, due to the telescoping mechanism. I had to cut 6 inches off the top of the outer tube, and also 6 inches off the bottom of the inner one. Then I needed to drill new holes in the outer tube for the locking pin to pass through. And also these stopper pieces bent and welded in place on the inner tube, so you can't accidentally extend it too far. And then reassembly was just a matter of lifting the top beam back up in the air, bolting on the uprights, then lifting it a bit farther and bolting on the bottom struts, now with casters attached. And it all worked great. It can roll out of the garage on the original casters now, lift items without worrying about retracting the casters, and I was able to back a flatbed in under it without any problems. So, nothing too fancy. But I thought I should use the footage since I had bothered filming it. Plus, the algorithm did not like me stepping out of my lane with that video about my hike around SF Bay, even though all the comments were really supportive, so I figured I should do something more on-brand to try and get back in its good graces. In the meantime, I'm putting in a lot of time at the shop, heading up most nights to work on Goose 2, which means a lot of kilometers on the cargo bike, coming back in the wee hours when I've got the city to myself, just me and a ridiculous ramshackle bamboo cargo bike. Those are good rides. I really am trying to finally get that stained glass video out before the end of the year, I promise. But until then, cheers.